Jane Opper. I'm here in Amagansett in my father John Opper's studio with my brother Joe. Behind me is one of my father's works from 1989. This is the wall he used for painting. I'd like to share with you some of the stories my father told me about his life, and Joe is taking this video. When we grew up, Joe and I were surrounded by abstract art and abstract painters. But it wasn't until 1926, when my dad was 18 years old, that he was first introduced to modern art. He was going to college at the Cleveland School of Art, and one of his teachers suggested that the students go to the Pittsburgh Carnegie International to see some European painters. So they got on the train and went to Pittsburgh. They were blown away by what they saw. Picasso, Braque, Monet, Matisse. It was something that they had never seen before. And in fact, Dad said, they were very disturbed by what they saw because they were used to painting from real life. Some of the kids started laughing. Dad said that he was very taken with the works of Matisse and his use of color and pattern. But it wasn't really until after my father graduated from the Cleveland School of Art and Western Reserve University that he immersed himself in painting. This was the Depression, and so really you couldn't find a job at all, and in some ways this meant that the world was your opportunity because you could accept doing anything. So he decided in 1933 to go to New York City. But for that first summer, he went to Gloucester, Massachusetts. He had heard that it was an artist colony with a quarry and a harbor with fishing ships, which would be just perfect for painting. So Dad got his painting supplies, put them in a box, loaded up with painting boards, not canvas. He thought the painting boards would be more versatile. When he was getting off the bus, he looked out and he saw this very tall man with a mustache smoking a pipe and a short woman next to him. They were laughing hysterically, holding their ribs, laughing so hard. The fellow said, "What? Do you think this is the wilderness? Don't you think we have paint supplies here?" The couple were Milton and Sally Avery. They introduced Dad to many of the painters who were in Gloucester, and most important, to Hans Hofmann, who was teaching at the Thurn School that summer. Although Dad never took a course with Hofmann at Thurn, he did get to talk to Hofmann, and he showed Hofmann what he was doing. Hofmann said, "When you get to New York, you should think about painting in a more modern vein." So when Dad arrived in New York City, Avery invited him to join a group of painters who were working in his studio, sketching from a model. They all chipped in to cover the cost. There, he met Adolf Gottlieb and Mark Rothko. Dad decided to go to the Hofmann studio, which was located on 57th Street. A little later, it would move down to Greenwich Village. In that first year with Hofmann, and he spent several, he was really immersed in the world of abstract art. Hofmann told Dad some of the great things that were fundamental for his painting. The importance of color, spatial dynamics, movement, intuition, and nature. Equally important to my father, he met some of his lifelong friends there. George McNeil, who became his best friend, Giorgio Cavallon, Byron Brown, Lee Krasner, whom he also knew out here in Springs. And it was a little later that he met Jackson Pollock, not through Lee, but through Jackson's brother, who was a painter. He also met de Kooning. The time was 1936, and Dad needed some work. It was a height of the Depression, and friends said, "You should get on one of the projects." So he went down and he signed up for the easel division. On the easel project, the government would give painters the supplies they needed, brushes, paints, canvas, paper. And in return, the painters had to turn in either a painting every 3 weeks or a watercolor every 2 weeks. My father opted for the watercolors. At this time, it was very hard to show abstract art, if you were American, in a gallery. The New York galleries were focusing on New York painters. So a group got together to form the pioneering American abstract artist. They made arrangements to show the art of these young painters themselves. And so Dad was with the American abstract artist for 3 years and exhibited 3 times with them. They were formed in 1936, and the first exhibition was in 37. Following the war, in the late 40s, Dad decided to go to Columbia University for a doctorate. While he was studying, he taught at night at Pratt. I think that he probably got the job through his friend, George McNeil. At Pratt, he met Franz Klein and Philip Guston. These friends would meet on a regular basis, going to galleries, going to gathering places, and above all, meeting at the Cedar Bar in Greenwich Village, which they would laugh a lot, talk about what they were doing, and exchange ideas. They also would argue, and that was one of my father's favorite things to do, to get deep into a conversation about art and argue with you. One night, while he was at the Cedar Bar, he was sitting with Franz Klein and Philip Guston, and they all began to sketch each other, actually. And Klein and Guston did their drawings on paper napkins. Dad grabbed an empty menu sheet of paper, and he did his sketches. These are really wonderful caricatures. Fortunately, my father brought them home to my mother. My mother saved them, and I now have them hanging on my wall. For 5 years, my father moved to Greensboro, North Carolina, where he taught at Women's College of the University of North Carolina. But he never cut off his contacts with New York and came back frequently to see friends, to go to galleries, and to gather in the Cedar Bar. On one trip, he lamented to George McNeil that he felt that his students really had no exposure to abstract art. And so George said, "But John, I have a car, we'll drive down." And sure enough, in the spring of 53, George McNeil, Jack Torkoff, Franz Klein, and the gallery owner, Charlie Egan, got in George's car and arrived in Greensboro. They had sent some paintings ahead. It was a wonderful symposium. The students were absolutely enthralled, and I remember a terrific evening that my parents had in their home in Greensboro for all the artists. Another time, the following year, Grace Hartigan, along with sculptor Ibram Lassaw and critic Thomas Hess, came down to Greensboro as well. In 1954, Dad was given some money by the school to go up to New York to buy some paintings in honor of one of their donors, a woman. He was given $1,800. When he got to New York, Dad phoned up de Kooning and said, "Bill, can I come to your studio to see what you're doing?" This was the period when de Kooning was working on his women's series. Dad looked around, marveled at everything, studied, and after some contemplation, decided that he liked a very large painting that had been done in 1949-50. "Bill, how much do you want for this?" "How much you got?" "$1,800. "Then I want $1,800 for the painting." "Deal," my father said. So he bought the painting entitled Woman. It was sent down to the University of North Carolina at Greensboro, Women's College, and everybody hated it. They were very upset that he had blown the whole amount of money on one painting, and this was a painting with the eyes skewed, big pink breasts, black marks all over the canvas, and every gestural direction, and they thought it was a travesty that this was supposed to honor a woman. The painting was dubbed Opera's Folly, and when Joe went down in the 1990s, he found that there was still a plaque on the wall saying Opera's Folly. The plaque no longer is up there, and the painting is one of the treasures of the Weatherspoon Art Gallery. It is now worth millions of dollars. In the fall of 1957, Dad returned to New York City, and he looked for a studio. The first studio he found was over at Jackson Square at Horatio and 8th Avenue, and it was a storefront. And so what I remember that Dad took soap and soaped up the windows so no one could look inside. But this was very short-lived because the storefront was slated for demolition. The building next door, a huge apartment, was going to expand and take over that space. So my father set out to find another studio. We were living on King Street, and rather than going north and west, he went east over to the Bowery. Now, you have to imagine that the Bowery was quite different from what it is today. It was really, although the Third Avenue L had disappeared, it was a very depressing place. There were a lot of homeless people, a lot of bums, a lot of winos. There were shops, hotels that on the down and out could stay in inexpensively during the night. And you would see steel drums in winter with fire in them so that people could stay warm. In any case, as Dad was walking down, he got to 222 Bowery. He looked up at this wonderful brick building with some arched windows and then big windows on top of it. And he thought, this must be an old Y building. He walked inside, and the bottom floor was being used as a store. It sold chairs and stools. He walked in and asked to speak to the owner. The fellow who answered was also the manager, and Sam said, yeah, what can I do for you? He said, I wondered, those spaces up above, it doesn't look like they're occupied. And he was told that they weren't. He said, would you consider giving that space to artists for rent? I'd like to rent it from you. Absolutely not, Sam said. Artists are unreliable and I won't get any money. After some persuasion, Dad got Sam to agree to let him come to the space. And so he chose the third floor, which he shared with his friend James Brooks. And what they did was they divided the studio in half and put up something like wall boards or some other material that was popular at the time, but it cut out sound, and actually it was much like this kind of material, I don't know what it's called, that's on the painting wall. This was not a very glamorous studio in the sense that there was a bathroom out on the landing, but it was a fantastic space, and my father absolutely loved it. In that spring, he was talking to Mark Rothko, and Rothko had just gotten the commission from to do a series of murals for the Seagram's building and the Four Seasons. Rothko said to Dad that he really was worried about this because his own studio was not big enough. Mark, why don't you come down to the Bowery? There's a fantastic gym all the way up on top with wonderful light and enough space for you to build to do your murals. Rothko looked and was delighted, and this is where the famous murals that now hang in the Tate were created. Opera kept the Bowery Studio all of his life until he died in 1994. In 62, he built the studio where I am today, and he would alternate between the two studios, always painting in them depending on where he was. Today, 222 Bowery is a landmark building because of the many famous artists who live there and work there, more importantly, in the studios. My father painted in many different styles, but one element that is always constant was his love of color. and his ability to bring out vibrant, lively action. He was taken with color and shape moving across a two-dimensional surface. When he talked to me about de Kooning's work, he said one of the things he really liked was dissonant color. That is the use of yellow and pink, things you wouldn't think together. And if you look at my father's paintings, you'll see that he puts red and orange together with purple, green and black. There were no limitations. All hues can be combined. For Dad, dissonant color created a kind of harmony. Barry Campbell Gallery in Chelsea is exhibiting my father's late works in a show entitled John Opper, Harmonies, Works from the 1980s. It is on from November 19th to December 23rd. Joe and I hope you will come to the gallery to see the show either in person or on a virtual tour.